A lot of people are confused about glycemic index versus glycemic load. So today we're going to explain. Stay tuned. Hey, I'm Dr. Ekberg with Wellness for Life. And if you'd like to truly master health by understanding how the body really works, make sure that you subscribe and hit that notification bell so that you don't miss anything. So a lot of patients come in and they talk about glycemic index and glycemic load because in our office, we talk a lot about carbohydrates and how you want to try to reduce overall carbohydrates for most people to get healthy. And then they read around and they find glycemic index and they ask, what's that all about? So here's how it works. Glycemic index is a measurement of how quickly something that you eat gets digested and turned into blood sugar. Well, glycemic means sugar. So if you eat something with a lot of sugar that's readily accessible, it's going to get into your bloodstream faster and have a higher glycemic index. If you eat something with no carbohydrates, then it will raise your glycemic index very, very slightly or not at all. So now here's the part that we have to clarify as we go through this. The official guidelines are that a high glycemic index is above 70, a medium glycemic index is 56 to 70, and a low glycemic index is lower than 56. So how do they come up with these numbers? Well, they're all relative to glucose. So pure glucose, or grape sugar, or dextrose, it's the same thing, is the index of 100. That's the reference. So based on that reference, sucrose, or pure white table sugar, is 68. So that's absorbed slower because it's a component, it's a combination of glucose and fructose. Now, when we look at wheat bread, that some people say is a complex carbohydrate and therefore absorbed slowly, we find that wheat bread is absorbed faster. It turns into sugar in your body faster than pure table sugar. And then some people argue that, oh, well, then table sugar isn't so bad after all. Well, it's all relative, and we're going to talk about how pure table sugar is a really bad idea and how wheat bread is even worse. Then you look at corn. So corn on the cob has a glycemic index of 55. So according to this scale, that looks like a virtual health food. And spaghetti, a complex carbohydrate, is 44. So again, is that a health food? They say that, well, glycemic index isn't such a good measurement because it doesn't tell you, it doesn't give you the impact. It doesn't give you an idea of how much total impact or volume it has to raise your blood sugar. Because some things have, like glucose or table sugar, you're not going to eat a half a pound at a time. Not most of us, I hope. You might have 2 teaspoons. So that would give it 10 grams of carbs. And then you multiply the glycemic index by the number of carbs and you end up with the glycemic load. So now you have a measurement of how much, not just how quickly would a certain amount enter your bloodstream, but how much of an impact does it have on your overall blood sugar. Then they say that a glycemic load, a high glycemic load per serving is over 20. A medium load is 11 to 20, and a low glycemic load is less than 11. So now it looks like glucose and table sugar are really good because they're less than 11. And we find out that wheat bread is high because it's 20, and corn on the cob and spaghetti are somewhere in between, they're medium. And then they also say that you should try to keep your glycemic load, your total glycemic load, the total impact of each meal, each serving, they should add up to less than 120, and then they say that you're okay. But in my mind, this is just crazy. And I don't know where they get these numbers, but I suspect that these are the same people that also think that the food pyramid is a good idea, that say that 8 to 11 servings of grains every day is what humans should have. And if we look at the total number of carbs here, if we eat the recommended 60% of calories from carbs on a 2,000 calorie diet, that comes out to 300 grams of carbs. And that, in my mind, is what's going to cause or contribute to diabetes very quickly. So far, those are the official guidelines, the high, medium, low glycemic load, the high, medium, low glycemic index. So if you're on a carb, on a low carb diet, if you're talking about paleo, if you're talking about keto or close to it, what are some real world numbers that we want to look at in comparison? Virtually all of the glycemic indices that you see are on grains and processed foods and things like that. Because meat and egg and cheese and so on have virtually no carbohydrates, they're not considered to even have a glycemic index. Even if they do have a slight response in insulin, they're considered a zero glycemic index food. And therefore, it's very difficult to find numbers. They might have a low single number, less than 10, but we're just gonna sort of ignore those for now and just let's say that they're very, very low. And then when we look at the number of carbs per serving of meat, egg, and cheese, we find that they are 0, 0, 0. So on a keto diet, this is what we want to look for. We want to eat foods that are basically zero or close to it. And in that category, we also find non-starchy vegetables, full-fat dairy, and some berries, such as raspberries, strawberries, and blueberries. And in a serving, you get anywhere from 1 to 5 grams of carbs from non-starchy vegetables. You get between 0 and 10 from dairy, depending on if it's butter or cream versus regular yogurt or milk. And with berries, you get 5 to 10 grams. But also these foods have very low glycemic indices. So for meat and egg and cheese, we get zero glycemic load, meaning you can eat as much as you want of those all day long and not have any impact whatsoever. And the non-starchy vegetables, full-fat dairy, and berries, you can still have servings and stay between 1 and 2 in the glycemic load. From the people who study and are of similar opinions, the people I've done the studied the research on low carbohydrate diets, on insulin resistance and overall health, generally feel that you want to try, if you're healthy and you want to try to stay that way, you should probably consume somewhere around 70 grams of carbs per day or less. And if you are insulin resistant or you have an inflammatory problem or some kind of degenerative condition that you're trying to reverse, you should probably try to keep it between 20 and 50, at least long enough that you can recover and reverse some of those conditions. So when we look at the glycemic load, 120 again is a crazy high number. We want to try to stick below 20 if we're healthy and want to stay that way, and probably between 4 to 10 if we're trying to reverse some condition. So which one is better? Well, I would recommend that you just count carbs. You count net carbs, you take the total carbs, you subtract the fiber, that gives you the net carbs, and you try to keep those in a low range. It really just kind of complicates things to looking at glycemic index and glycemic loads, especially since the official guidelines are sort of outrageous. You get a very, very good idea. You don't have to complicate things so much. If you just count net carbs and you keep them low, then you're going to be okay. I hope this explanation has been helpful. If you have any questions, suggestions, experiences, let me know. Post your comments down below and I'll do my very best to get back to you and answer those. If you're new to this channel and you enjoy this sort of content, make sure that you subscribe and hit that notification bell so that you don't miss anything. Thanks for watching.